The European Union is right now working on a consolidated corporate income tax base for large companies that work in cross-border situations within the European Union. This isn't there yet. As a matter of fact, the current commissioner recently announced that the topic is going to be on the agenda again. And as a matter of fact, next week on Tuesday, there's going to be in Brussels a first meeting with outside experts in which the new ideas about this consolidated corporate tax base will be discussed. But in addition to whole taxes like value-added tax and perhaps corporate income tax, quite a bit of work has been done to harmonize particular cross-border tax events, like dividends being paid by a parent, by a subsidiary in one country to a parent in the other country, mergers involving companies or activities in different EU member states, interest and royalties being paid in intra-group transactions, income from savings that individuals derive from savings accounts in foreign countries. In all these instances, the EU member states were required on the basis of their of these directives to harmonize their, to bring their domestic law in line with these directives, and in this way there was a very sort of active way of tax harmonization accomplished. Although these initiatives were important, still, I would say between 80 and 90% of the tax rules in the European Union are not harmonized. And in that area, the ECJ, the European Court of Justice, has taken a role that it assumed in the year 1976, when its first decision was issued that was based on one of the four freedom of movement provisions. In the treaty, there are four clauses that guarantee that persons, individuals, companies, should be free to move within the European Union. And important for us today are particularly the rules on the free movement of direct investment. A company should be free to set up a subsidiary company in another country, should be free to set up a branch operation in another country without adverse tax effects. There's also a freedom on passive investment. The court, the ECJ, has increasingly taken a very aggressive, that is aggressive towards the governments and very favorable to taxpayers, aggressive approach in forcing countries to recognize these freedom rules and to force countries to bring the domestic law in line with these freedom rules. And in this way, the ECJ is said to be a great power, a great motor engine to, in a negative way, to harmonize the tax system, because the court cannot make rules. The court can tell countries that particular domestic rules are detrimental to the effective operation of the common market. So the harmonization is realized in two ways. Directives, positive way, court, negative, by telling countries you cannot do this, you cannot do that, you have to adjust your tax system. And in both areas, there were interesting aspects for anti-avoidance. The question in the first place is, if, like a value-added tax directive, does not contain any sort of overall anti-avoidance rule, can a country, can a member state use any of its domestic anti-avoidance rules in denying to a taxpayer benefits that the taxpayer is entitled to under a EU directive like the VAT directive? And only recently, a few years ago, the ECJ had the opportunity to make a very clear and stern pronouncement in this area. You see the text, the particular paragraph from the decision in italics at the lower part of the slate. So the court effectively said that a national court may take account of the purely artificial nature of particular transactions, and if it's recognized that the nature is indeed artificial, a court, a country may deny particular benefits that the taxpayer otherwise would derive from the directive as implemented by that given country in its domestic tax law. A second area where anti-avoidance has become relevant in EU tax law, second area concerns the directives. The parent directive, the merge directive, and also other directives contain particular rules that allow countries to act against particular avoidance tactics by taxpayers. Here you see the rule which is laid down in the parent subsidiary directive. It says the directive does not need to be applied by a country if that country's domestic or treaty-based anti-avoidance rules would prohibit a taxpayer to benefit from the directive. So it is an enormously wide authority given by the EU to countries to simply apply their own domestic anti-avoidance rules. In the merger directive, it is a bit different. There was no reference to what countries have laid down in their own law in respect of anti-avoidance. No, a reference is made to something like a business purpose test. It says, Article 11, a member state may refuse the benefits of the directives to taxpayers in cases where a transaction has as its principal objective, or as one of its principal objectives, tax evasion or tax avoidance. And see, it says further that the operations are not carried out for valid commercial reasons. Well, this of course is a directive which initially will be read and interpreted and applied by a domestic court. If a domestic court, and that's typically something of European law, if a domestic court has any doubt as to whether a particular domestic rule has or is covered by this language in the directive, the domestic court may request the ECJ to give its view on the way the domestic rule will be covered or not covered perhaps by this particular directive rule. So the ECJ is sort of the official interpreter of whatever is laid down in the EU treaty or in the directives. And also in this area, the EU, the ECJ will keep playing a very important role in dealing with how cross-border transactions within the European Union, within the framework of these directives, are going to be considered either as being covered by rules against tax avoidance and evasion or not. I think I have more than exhausted the time allocated to me. So as a concluding observation, I would say in Europe, many things are happening at the same time. I would say in the last one or two decades, we have seen developments which are much greater than anything we saw before. Within the EU, there is this harmonized effect. Outside EU tax law, countries pretty much do their own thing, although increasingly countries are very interested in finding out how particular rules work in neighboring countries. And well, if things turn out to work well, countries don't mind to simply copy foreign rules into their own law and in this way benefit from the experience that other countries have gained in this area. Thanks.